near Milton Keynes in Buckinghamshire, constructed during the years following 1883 for the English financier and politician Sir Herbert Samuel Leon in the Victorian Gothic, Tudor, and Dutch Baroque styles, on the site of older buildings of the same name. It has received latter-day fame as the central site for British, and subsequently, Allied, codebreakers during World War II, although at the time of their operation this fact was a closely guarded secret. During the Second World War, the estate housed the British Government Code and Cypher School, GC&CS, which regularly penetrated the secret communications of the Axis Powers, most importantly the German Enigma and Lorenz ciphers. Among its most notable early personnel, the GC&CS team of codebreakers included Alan Turing, Gordon Welchman, Hugh Alexander and Stuart Milner-Barry. According to the official historian of British intelligence, the ultra intelligence produced at Bletchley shortened the war by 2 to 4 years, and without it the outcome of the war would have been uncertain. The team at Bletchley Park devised automatic machinery to help with decryption, culminating in the development of Colossus, the world's first programmable digital electronic computer. Codebreaking operations at Bletchley Park came to an end in 1946, and all information about the wartime operations was classified until the mid-1970s. After the war, the post office took over the site and used it as a management school, but by 1990 the huts in which the codebreakers worked were being considered for demolition and redevelopment, and the Bletchley Park Trust formed in 1991 to save large portions of the site from developers. More recently, Bletchley Park has been open to the public and houses interpretive exhibits and rebuilt huts as they would have appeared during their wartime operations, as well as the National Museum of Computing, established on the site, which includes a rebuilt Colossus machine, and receives hundreds of thousands of visitors annually. The site appears in the Domesday Book as part of the Manor of Eton. Brown Willis built a mansion there in 1711, but after Thomas Harrison purchased the property in 1793 this was pulled down. It was first known as Bletchley Park after its purchase by Samuel Lipscomb II in 1877. The estate of was bought in 1883 by Sir Herbert Samuel Leon, who expanded the then existing farmhouse into what architect Landis Gore called a maudlin and monstrous pile combining Victorian Gothic, Tudor, and Dutch Baroque styles. In 1938, the mansion and much of the site was bought by a builder planning a housing estate, but in May 1938 Admiral Sir Hugh Sinclair, head of the Secret Intelligence Service, CIS or MI6, bought the mansion and of land for £6,000, using his own money after the government said they did not have the budget to do so, for use by GC&CS and CIS in the event of war. A key advantage seen by Sinclair and his colleagues, inspecting the site under the cover of Captain Ridley's shooting party, was Bletchley's geographical centrality. It was almost immediately adjacent to Bletchley Railway Station, where the varsity line between Oxford and Cambridge was universities were expected to supply many of the codebreakers met the main West Coast Railway line connecting London, Birmingham, Manchester, Liverpool, Glasgow, and Edinburgh. Watling Street, the main road linking London to the northwest, subsequently the A5, was close by, and high-volume communication links were available at the telegraph and telephone repeater station in nearby Fenny Stratford. Bletchley Park was known as BP to those who worked there. Station X, X equals Roman numeral 10, London Signals Intelligence Centre, and Government Communications Headquarters were all cover names used during the war. The formal posting of the many Wrens members of the Women's Royal Naval Service working there was to HMS Pembroke the 5th. Royal Air Force names of Bletchley Park and its outstations included RAF Eastcote, RAF Lime Grove and RAF Church Green. The postal address that staff had to use was Room 47, Foreign Office. After the war, the Government Code and Cipher School became the Government Communications Headquarters, GCHQ, moving to Eastcote in 1946 and to Cheltenham in the 1950s. The site was used by various government agencies, including the GPO and the Civil Aviation Authority. One large building, Block F, was demolished in 1987, by which time the site was being run down with tenants leaving. In 1990 the site was at risk of being sold for housing development. However, Milton Keynes Council made it into a conservation area. Bletchley Park Trust was set up in 1991 by a group of people who recognized the site's importance. The initial trustees included Roger Bristow, Ted Enever, Peter Wescombe, Dr. Peter Jarvis of the Bletchley Archaeological and Historical Society, and Tony Sale, who in 1994 became the first director of the Bletchley Park Museums. Commander Alistair Denniston was operational head of GC&CS from 1919 to 1942, beginning with its formation from the Admiralty's Room 40, Nid 25, and the War Office's MI1B. Key GC&CS crypt analysts who moved from London to Bletchley Park included John Tiltman, Dilwyn Dilly Knox, Josh Cooper, and Nigel de Grey. These people had a variety of backgrounds. Linguists and chess champions were common, and in Knox's case papyrology. The British War Office recruited top solvers of cryptic crossword puzzles, as these individuals had strong lateral thinking skills. On the day Britain declared war on Germany, Denniston wrote to the Foreign Office about recruiting men of the professor type. Personal networking drove early recruitments, particularly of men from the universities of Cambridge and Oxford. Trustworthy women were similarly recruited for administrative and clerical jobs. In one 1941 recruiting stratagem, the Daily Telegraph was asked to organize a crossword competition, after which promising contestants were discreetly approached about a particular type of work as a contribution to the war effort. Denniston recognized, however, that the enemy's use of electromechanical cipher machines meant that formally trained mathematicians would also be needed. Oxford's Peter Twin joined GC&CS in February 1939, Cambridge's Alan Turing and Gordon Welchman began training in 1938 and reported to Bletchley Theatre after war was declared, along with John Jeffreys. Later recruited cryptanalysts included the mathematicians Derek Taunt, Jack Good, Bill Tute, and Max Newman, historian Harry Hinsley, and chess champions Hugh Alexander and Stuart Milner-Barry. Joan Clark, eventually deputy head of Hut 8, was one of the few women employed at Bletchley as a full-fledged cryptanalyst. This eclectic staff of boffins and devs, scientists and debutantes, young women of high society, caused GC&CS to be whimsically dubbed the Golf, Cheese and Chess Society. During a September 1941 morale-boosting visit, Winston Churchill reportedly remarked to Denniston, "I told you to leave no stone unturned to get staff, but I had no idea you had taken me so literally." 6 weeks later, having failed to get sufficient typing and unskilled staff to achieve the productivity that was possible, Turing, Welchman, Alexander and Milner-Barry wrote directly to Churchill. His response was, "Action this day, make sure they have all they want on extreme priority and report to me that this has been done." After initial training at the Inter-Service Special Intelligence School set up by John Tiltman, initially at an RAF depot in Buckingham and later in Bedford where it was known locally as the Spy School, staff worked a six-day week, rotating through three shifts, 4 p.m. to midnight, midnight to 8 a.m., the most disliked shift, and 8 a.m. to 4 p.m., each with a half-hour meal break. At the end of the third week, a worker went off at 8 a.m. and came back at 4 p.m., thus putting in 16 hours on that last day. The irregular hours affected workers' health and social life, as well as the routine as of the nearby homes at which most staff lodged. The work was tedious and demanded intense concentration. Staff got 1 week's leave 4 times a year, but some girls collapsed and required extended rest. Recruitment took place to combat a shortage of experts in Morse code and German. In January 1945, at the peak of code-breaking efforts, some 10,000 personnel were working at Bletchley and its outstations. About three-quarters of these were women. Many of the women came from middle-class backgrounds and held degrees in the areas of mathematics, physics and engineering. They were given entry into STEM programs due to the lack of men, who had been sent to war. They performed complex calculations and coding and hence were integral to the computing processes. For example, Eleanor Ireland worked on the Colossus computers. The female staff in Dilwyn Knox's section were sometimes termed Dilly's fillies. Dilly's girls included Jean Perrin, Claire Harding, Rachel Ronald, and Elizabeth Granger. Jane Hughes processed information leading to the last battle of the Bismarck. Mavis Lever, who married mathematician and fellow codebreaker Keith Beatty, made the first break into the Italian naval traffic. She and Margaret Rock solved a German code, the Opfer break. Their work achieved official recognition only in 2009. Many of the women had backgrounds in languages, particularly French and German. Roseanne Colchester was a translator who worked at Bletchley from April 1942 until January 1945, mainly for the Italian Air Force's section. Like most of the Bletchleyettes, she came from the higher middle class, her father, Air Vice Marshal Sir Charles Medhurst, being an air attaché in Rome. Before joining Bletchley, Colchester was moving in high circles. She had met Hitler and been flirted with by Mussolini at an embassy party, writes Sarah Rainey. She joined the Park because she found it thrilling to fight for her country. Cicely Mayhew was recruited straight from university, having graduated from Lady Margaret Hall, Oxford in 1944 with a first in French and German, after only 2 years. She worked in Hut 8, translating decoded German Navy signals. Ruth Briggs, a German scholar, worked within the naval section and was known as one of the best cryptographers. She married Oliver Churchill of the Sioux. Properly used, the German Enigma and Lorenz ciphers should have been virtually unbreakable, but flaws in German cryptographic procedures, and poor discipline among the personnel carrying them out, created vulnerabilities that made Bletchley's attacks just barely feasible. These vulnerabilities, however, could have been remedied by relatively simple improvements in enemy procedures, and such changes would certainly have been implemented had Germany had any hint of Bletchley's success. Thus the intelligence Bletchley produced was considered wartime Britain's ultra-secret, higher even than the normally highest classification, and security was paramount. All staff signed the Official Secrets Act, 1939, and a 1942 security warning emphasized the importance of discretion even within Bletchley itself. Do not talk at meals. Do not talk in the transport. Do not talk traveling. Do not talk in the billet. Do not talk by your own fireside. Be careful even in your hut. Nevertheless, there were security leaks. Jock Colville, the assistant private secretary to Winston Churchill, recorded in his diary on July 31, 1941, that the newspaper proprietor Lord Camrose had discovered Ultra and that security leaks increase in number and seriousness. Without doubt, the most serious of these was that Bletchley Park had been infiltrated by John Cairncross, the notorious Soviet mole and member of the Cambridge spy ring, who leaked Ultra material to Moscow. The first personnel of the Government Code and Cipher School, GC&CS, moved to Bletchley Park on August 15, 1939. The naval, military, and air sections were on the ground floor of the mansion, together with a telephone exchange, teleprinter room, kitchen, and dining room. The top floor was allocated to MI6. Construction of the wooden huts began in late 1939, and Elmer's School, a neighboring boys' boarding school in a Victorian Gothic red brick building by a church, was acquired for the commercial and diplomatic sections. After the United States joined World War II, a number of American cryptographers were posted to Hut 3, and from May 1943 onwards there was close cooperation between British and American intelligence. See 1943 Brusa Agreement. In contrast, the Soviet Union was never officially told of Bletchley Park and its activity, as a reflection of Churchill's distrust of the Soviets even during the US-UK-USSR alliance imposed by the Nazi threat. The only direct enemy damage to the site was done 2021 November 1940 by three bombs probably intended for Bletchley Railway Station. Hut 4, shifted 2 feet off its foundation, was winched back into place as work inside continued. Non-naval Enigma messages were deciphered in Hut 6, followed by translation, indexing and cross-referencing, in Hut 3. Only then was it sent out to the Secret Intelligence Service, MI6. The intelligence chiefs in the relevant ministries, and later on to high-level commanders in the field. Naval Enigma deciphering was in Hut 8, with translation in Hut 4. Verbatim translations were sent only to the Naval Intelligence Division, NID, of the Admiralty's Operational Intelligence Center, OIC, supplemented by information from indexes as to the meaning of technical terms and cross-references from a knowledge store of German naval technology. Hut 4 also decoded a manual system known as the Dockyard Cipher, which sometimes carried messages that were also sent on an Enigma network. Feeding these back to Hut 8 provided excellent cribs for known plaintext attacks on the daily naval Enigma key. Initially, a wireless room was established at Bletchley Park. It was set up in the mansion's water tower under the code name Station X, a term now sometimes applied to the code-breaking efforts at Bletchley as a whole. The X is the Roman numeral 10. This being the Secret Intelligence Service's 10th such station. Due to the long radio aerials stretching from the wireless room, the radio station was moved from Bletchley Park to nearby Waddon Hall to avoid drawing attention to the site. Subsequently, other listening stations, Y stations, such as the ones at Chicksands in Bedfordshire, Bow Manor Hall, Leicestershire, where the headquarters of the War Office E Group was located, and Beeston Hill E Station in Norfolk gathered raw signals for processing at Bletchley. Coded messages were taken down by hand and sent to Bletchley on paper by motorcycle dispatch riders or, later, by teleprinter. The wartime needs required the building of additional accommodation. Often a hut's number became so strongly associated with the work performed inside that even when the work was moved to another building it was still referred to by the original hut designation. In addition to the wooden huts, there were a number of brick-built blocks. Most German messages decrypted at Bletchley were produced by one or another version of the Enigma cipher machine, but an important minority were produced by the even more complicated 12-rotor Lorenz SC42 online teleprinter cipher machine. 5 weeks before the outbreak of war, Warsaw's Cypher Bureau revealed its achievements in breaking Enigma to astonished French and British personnel. The British used the Poles' information and techniques, and the Enigma clone sent to them in August 1939, which greatly increased their previously very limited success in decrypting Enigma messages. The Bombay was an electromechanical device whose function was to discover some of the daily settings of the Enigma machines on the various German military networks. Its pioneering design was developed by Alan Turing, with an important contribution from Gordon Welchman, and the machine was engineered by Harold Dockeen of the British Tabulating Machine Company. Each machine was about high and wide, deep and weighed about a ton. At its peak, GC&CS was reading approximately 4,000 messages per day. As a hedge against enemy attack, most bombs were dispersed to installations at Hadstockane-Wavendon, both later supplanted by installations at Stanmore and Eastcote, and Gayhurst. Luftwaffe messages were the first to be read in quantity. The German Navy had much tighter procedures, and the capture of code books was needed before they could be broken. When, in February 1942, the German Navy introduced the four-rotor Enigma for communications with its Atlantic U-boats, this traffic became unreadable for a period of 10 months. Britain produced modified bombs, but it was the success of the U.S. Navy Bombay that was the main source of reading messages from this version of Enigma for the rest of the war. Messages were sent to and fro across the Atlantic by enciphered teleprinter links. The Lorenz messages were codenamed Tunny at Bletchley Park. They were only sent in quantity from mid-1942. The Tunny networks were used for high-level messages between German high command and field commanders. With the help of German operator errors, the cryptanalysts in the testery, named after Ralph Tester, its head, worked out the logical structure of the machine despite not knowing its physical form. They devised automatic machinery to help with decryption, which culminated in Colossus, the world's first programmable digital electronic computer. This was designed and built by Tommy Flowers and his team at Post Office Research Station at Dollis Hill. The prototype first worked in December 1943. Was delivered to Bletchley Park in January and first worked operationally February 5, 1944. Enhancements were developed for the Mark II Colossus, the first of which was working at Bletchley Park on the morning of 1 June in time for D-Day. Flowers then produced one Colossus a month for the rest of the war, making a total of 10 with an 11th part built. The machines were operated mainly by runs in a section named the Newman Re after its head Max Newman. Bletchley's work was essential to defeating the U-boats in the Battle of the Atlantic, and to the British naval victories in the Battle of Cape Matapan and the Battle of North Cape. In 1941, Ultra exerted a powerful effect on the North African desert campaign against German forces under General Erwin Rommel. General Sir Claude Auchinleck wrote that were it not for Ultra, Rommel would have certainly got through to Cairo. While not changing the events, Ultra decrypts featured prominently in the story of Operation Salam, Laszlo Almassi's mission across the desert behind Allied lines in 1942. Prior to the Normandy landings on D-Day in June 1944, the Allies knew the locations of all but two of Germany's 58 Western Front divisions. Italian signals had been of interest since Italy's attack on Abyssinia in 1935. During the Spanish Civil War, the Italian Navy used the K model of the commercial Enigma without a plugboard. This was solved by Knox in 1937. When Italy entered the war in 1940, an improved version of the machine was used, though little traffic was sent by it and there were wholesale changes in Italian codes and ciphers. Knox was given a new section for work on Enigma variations, which he staffed with women, Dilly's girls, who included Margaret Rock, Jean Perrin, Claire Harding, Rachel Ronald, Elizabeth Granger, and Mavis Lever. Mavis Lever solved the signals revealing the Italian Navy's operational plans before the Battle of Cape Matapan in 1941, leading to a British victory. Although most Bletchley staff did not know the results of their work, Admiral Cunningham visited Bletchley in person a few weeks later to congratulate them. On entering World War II in June 1940, the Italians were using book codes for most of their military messages. The exception was the Italian Navy, which after the Battle of Cape Matapan started using the C-38 version of the Boris Hagelin rotor-based cipher machine, particularly to route their navy and merchant marine convoys to the conflict in North Africa. As a consequence, J.R.M. Butler recruited his former student Bernard Wilson to join a team with two others in Hut 4. In June 1941, Wilson became the first off-team to decode the Hagelin system, thus enabling military commanders to direct the Royal Navy and Royal Air Force to sink enemy ships carrying supplies from Europe to Rommel's Africa Corps. This led to increased shipping losses and, from reading the intercepted traffic, the team learned that between May and September 1941 the stock of fuel for the Luftwaffe in North Africa reduced by 90%. After an intensive language course, in March 1944 Wilson switched to Japanese language-based codes. A Middle East Intelligence Center, MEIC, was set up in Cairo in 1939. When Italy entered the war in June 1940, delays in forwarding intercepts to Bletchley via congested radio links resulted in cryptanalysts being sent to Cairo. A combined Bureau Middle East, CBME, was set up in November, though the Middle East authorities made increasingly bitter complaints that GC&CS was giving too little priority to work on Italian ciphers. However, the principle of concentrating high-grade cryptanalysis at Bletchley was maintained. John Chadwick started cryptanalysis work in 1942 on Italian signals at the naval base HMS Nile in Alexandria. Later, he was with GC&CS, in the Heliopolis Museum, Cairo, and then in the Villa Lawrence, Alexandria. Soviet signals had been studied since the 1920s. In 193,940, John Tiltman, who had worked on Russian army traffic from 1930, set up two Russian sections at Wavendon, a country house near Bletchley, and at Sarafand in Palestine. Two Russian high-grade army and navy systems were broken early in 1940. Tiltman spent 2 weeks in Finland, where he obtained Russian traffic from Finland and Estonia in exchange for radio equipment. In June 1941, when the Soviet Union became an ally, Churchill ordered a halt to intelligence operations against it. In December 1941, the Russian section was closed down, but in late summer 1943 or late 1944, a small GC&CS Russian cipher section was set up in London overlooking Park Lane, then in Sloane Square. An outpost of the Government Code and Cipher School had been set up in Hong Kong in 1935, the Far East Combined Bureau, FECB. The FECB naval staff moved in 1940 to Singapore, then Colombo, Ceylon, then Kilindini, Mombasa, Kenya. They succeeded in deciphering Japanese codes with a mixture of skill and good fortune. The Army and Air Force staff went from Singapore to the Wireless Experimental Center at Delhi, India. In early 1942, a six-month crash course in Japanese, for 20 undergraduates from Oxford and Cambridge, was started by the Inter-Services Special Intelligence School in Bedford, in a building across from the main post office. This course was repeated every 6 months until war's end. Most of those completing these courses worked on decoding Japanese naval messages in Hut 7, under John Tiltman. By mid-1945, well over 100 personnel were involved with this operation, which cooperated closely with the FECB and the U.S. Signal Intelligence Service at Arlington Hall, Virginia. In 1999, Michael Smith wrote that, "Only now are the British codebreakers, like John Tiltman, Hugh Foss, and Eric Knave, beginning to receive the recognition they deserve for breaking Japanese codes and ciphers." After the war, the secrecy imposed on Bletchley staff remained in force, so that most relatives never knew more than that a child, spouse, or parent had done some kind of secret war work. Churchill referred to the Bletchley staff as the geese that laid the golden eggs and never cackled. That said, occasional mentions of the work performed at Bletchley Park slipped the censor's net and appeared in print. With the publication of F.W. Winterbotham's The Ultra Secret, 1974, public discussion of Bletchley's work finally became possible, though even today some former staff still consider themselves bound to silence, and in July 2009 the British government announced that Bletchley personnel would be recognized with a commemorative badge. After the war, the site passed through a succession of hands and saw a number of uses, including as a teacher training college and local GPO headquarters. By 1991, the site was nearly empty and the buildings were at risk of demolition for redevelopment. In February 1992, the Milton Keynes Borough Council declared most of the park a conservation area, and the Bletchley Park Trust was formed to maintain the site as a museum. The site opened to visitors in 1993, and was formally inaugurated by HRH the Duke of Kent as chief patron in July 1994. In 1999 the landowners, the property advisors to the civil estate and BT, granted a lease the trust giving the trust control over most of the site. June 2014 saw the completion of an £8 million restoration project, which was marked by a visit from Catherine, Duchess of Cambridge. The Duchess' paternal grandmother, Valerie, and Valerie's twin sister, Mary, née Glassborough, both worked at Bletchley Park during the war. The twin sisters worked as Foreign Office civilians in Hut 6, where they managed the interception of enemy and neutral diplomatic signals for decryption. Valerie married Catherine's grandfather, Captain Peter Middleton. The Bletchley Park Learning Department offers educational group visits with active learning activities for schools and universities. Visits can be booked in advance during term time, where students can engage with the history of Bletchley Park and understand its wider relevance for computer history and national security. Their workshops cover introductions to codebreaking, cybersecurity, and the story of Enigma and Lorenz. In October 2005, American billionaire Sidney Frank donated £500,000 to Bletchley Park Trust to fund a new science center dedicated to Alan Turing. Simon Greenish joined as director in 2006 to lead a fundraising effort in a post he held until 2012 when Ian Standen took over the leadership role. In July 2008, a letter to The Times from more than 100 academics condemned the neglect of the site. In September 2008, PGP, IBM, and other technology firms announced a fundraising campaign to repair the facility. On November 6, 2008 it was announced that English Heritage would donate £300,000 to help maintain the buildings at Bletchley Park, and that they were in discussions regarding the donation of a further £600,000. In October 2011, the Bletchley Park Trust received a £4.6 million Heritage Lottery Fund grant to be used to complete the restoration of the site, and to tell its story to the highest modern standards on the condition that £1.7 million of match funding is raised by the Bletchley Park Trust. Just weeks later, Google contributed £550,000, and by June 2012 the trust had successfully raised £2.4 million to unlock the grants to restore Huts 3 and 6, as well as develop its exhibition center in Block C. Additional income is raised by renting Block H to the National Museum of Computing, and some office space in various parts of the park to private firms. The National Museum of Computing is housed in Block H, which is rented from the Bletchley Park Trust. Its Colossus and Tunney galleries tell an important Pertov Allied breaking of German codes during World War II. There is a working reconstruction of the Colossus computer that was used on the high-level Lorenz cipher, codenamed Tunney by the British. The museum, which opened in 2007, is an independent voluntary organization that is governed by its own board of trustees. Its aim is to collect and restore computer systems, particularly those developed in Britain, and to enable people to explore that collection for inspiration, learning, and enjoyment. Through its many exhibits, the museum displays the story of computing through the mainframes of the 1960s and 1970s, and the rise of personal computing in the 1980s. It has a policy of having as many of the exhibits as possible in full working order. The Colossus and Tunney galleries are open daily. The rest of the museum is open to the public every Thursday, Saturday and Sunday afternoons and most bank holidays, and by appointment for groups only, at other times. There are guided tours on Tuesday and Wednesday afternoons and Thursday morning. There is a modest admission charge to the museum to help cover overheads. The museum is working with four other organizations, in a group called CFARO, to create the new college for students between 16 and 19 years of age. It will be located in Block G, which was being renovated in 2017 with funding from the Bletchley Park Science and Innovation Center. Bletchley Park Trust has no involvement with the college. The National College of Cybersecurity is scheduled to open in 2018. The Radio Society of Great Britain's National Radio Center, including a library, radio station, museum and bookshop, are in a newly constructed building closet of the main Bletchley Park entrance. Bletchley Park is opposite Bletchley Railway Station. It is close to junctions 13 and 14 of the M1, located northwest of London. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.